Okay, thank you very much, Carlo. So, let's say I will try to teach you something. Although the main point is that I will probably also teach it to myself. Because, first of all, I have to thank the organizer for inviting me here, giving me the possibility of talking about binary system and gravitational waves. Evidently, when they asked me to do that, I was very excited and I was very ambitious. I said I will do a very great thing, complete. But then maybe at the practical level, this will be not exactly what I had in mind originally, because I wanted to have to do something that is informative but also formative. In the sense that the hope is also to give you tools in order to understand the papers that are written on gravitational waves, and eventually give you enough information so that you can orient within the literature, and maybe, why not, work on this, in the sense that if you know at least the language, the jargon, would be easier to read papers and maybe start doing research in this. Let's say this was the hope at the beginning. I don't know if I will be able to do that. Let's try. Anyway, so to start with, so the idea is to start from the very basics, so from the linearized theory of gravity, of flat space-time, but the final goal is to tell you how to compute the signals, theoretically, that were used to tell that LIGO in September 2015 was able to see a couple of black holes coalescing in end of, let's say, two black holes of masses 36 and 29 solar masses, that actually was a binary system that coalesced, that was, let's say, 1 billion years, light years away, that finally these two black holes merged together, giving rise to this signal. So the idea is to try to put together all the theoretical tools that are needed to compute the waveforms that here, that is, let's say, the analytical, or let's say the theoretical waveform that is behind the statement that these are two black holes, so and so. So first, what I want to stress is that this was the signal that was detected on September, but this was not the only signal that the LIGO detectors show. So, because actually there were two more signals, one in December 2015, that this was just five or let's say 10 orbits more or less, and it was focused on the merger. The other signal was about 30 orbits long, and it was let's say detected, extracted from the noise of the detector using match filtering technique. In other words, typically the gravitational wave signal are hidden within the detector noise because the signal to noise ratio is small. So to extract this signal from the noise, you need a very precise theoretical knowledge of the signal that you are looking for. And you just do correlation between the signal and the output of the detector, and if you find that the correlation is one, poof, you have detected something. In few words, okay? But this is the main idea, and in fact was proved to work in the case of the event of December. It is a much longer event than this. So I wanted to force myself to use, at least at the beginning, just the blackboard. I don't know if it will work, but let's try to summarize what is behind this. Because, as I said, one is a theoretical knowledge of the signal, and the theoretical knowledge stems from the following effects. On the one hand, you need a description of the dynamics of the two-body problem in general relativity, and on the other hand, you need a formalism to compute gravitational wave emission from the dynamics of the two-body problem. And if you want to start from something, where do we start? So, let's say, we start from 1 year, 1980 maybe, or after 1980. This is the moment when, in a sense, the theoretical tools that are used today, I mean, several development of the theoretical of these theoretical tools are used today to compute theoretically this waveform. So first of all, one has to remember that, let's say, in 1980, there is one paper of Kip Thorne that is maybe the last paper that is useful. Why are you laughing? I don't understand. Which is a paper where he was introducing the symmetric trace-free description of multipolar expansion of gravitational radiation. So this is one thing. Then in the years, let's say, I think from 1981, 1982, and up to 1986, I think I am just recalling by heart, there is the problem of the binary pulsar. So in 1974, there is this following thing. In 1974, Alsen Taylor discovered the binary pulsar. And what is the 1913 plus 16, okay? So the binary pulsar, and what was the point? The point is that you have the two objects. They are orbiting one around the other with a certain eccentricity. And this system emits gravitational waves. And the emission of gravitational waves produces a certain decay of the period, in the sense that at each revolution, the orbit is a little bit smaller. And you can compute this thing, in principle, very precisely in general relativity. But up to the, let's say, 1980 or 1981, maybe, there was a certain ambiguity, because doing calculation at the lowest order, there were several people who were doing calculation, and the results were not matching one with the other. From, I think, is in 1982, when we have all the papers of Damour and Derwell, where they computed the problem in general relativity, let's say the equation of motion in general relativity up to 2.5 pn, which means order v5 over c5, which includes the fact that in a correct self-consistent way, the effect of radiation damping. So this effect, the system emits gravitational waves, and then the waves back react on the system. And this produces a shrinkage of the waves. So, and this eventually was, I mean, all this lineage of work arrived up to, I think, 1993 or so. This, all the formalism that was developed at the time allowed to do very precise test of general relativity on the binary pulsars. After this first binary pulsar, there were other pulsars, binary pulsars that were discovered, and all these systems allowed for a very, very precise test of general relativity. And what is usually called the indirect proof of the existence of gravitational waves. But say the basis of what is used now were laid down at the beginning of the 80s. Okay, I'm just citing by heart in order to give a general overview of what the things are and what are, let's say, the good authors. Evidently, if you look at any of the papers of Thibaut Damour and co-workers, a bit tough in reading, and but at the end you will be rewarded by a deeper understanding of things. Then what happens? So, and what is the formalism? So, what the main point is, I have to study the dynamics of two objects that have, let's say, the masses can be one comparable to the other, and eventually, I should solve the Einstein equation for this thing. Taking into account, so you have to compute the metric generated by the motion of the two bodies, and then the back reaction effect of this thing. So the basic technique to do this, analytical technique to do this, when you have comparable masses, because in other situations when one mass is much larger than the other, you can resort to other approximation scheme, is what is called the post-Newtonian approximation. And And this is a huge thing that I'm unable to describe in detail because I've never really worked on post-Newtonian theory. So I have, in a sense, just a knowledge that comes from reading papers of others or reading books or whatever. But this is a very powerful tool that allows you to solve Einstein equation iteratively in as a v over c square, where v, let's say, is a characteristic velocity of the system. And actually, the post-Newtonian approximation is just a word. It's a mixture of post-Newtonian, so let's say at the lowest order, what you do is basically a perturbation on Newton's theory, and the perturbation is this is the parameter that you use for writing your perturbative series. And nowadays, the post-Newtonian calculations are have arrived at a very sophisticated level, and they are you need, and in the sense that nowadays what we have is of the system that can be described. Okay, what I forgot to mention is that when we talk of the dynamics of a binary system, the dynamics can be approximately split in two pieces. A conservative part, which is eventually described by a Hamiltonian, and a non-conservative part. So the fact that the system emits gravitational waves, this back react, and the system is, the orbit is shrinking, so there are damping terms that are typically expressed like, let's say, a flux that can be energy flux or angular momentum flux. And what post-Newtonian theory gives you is allows you to compute these pieces as a series. So let's say something like that, 1pn plus 1 over c4 h2pn, and so on and so forth. And nowadays, for the, c2, c3, one of C4. Am I writing something? V square over C square. Yes, C4, C6, H3PN. And nowadays, the knowledge of the Hamiltonian of the two-body problem in general relativity, and we are talking about two black holes, is known up to 4PN order. So, and this is, let's say, the Murray Aronofsky Schaefer 2016, okay? Similarly, you have the flux that is again computed as a similar. So there are a certain bunch of techniques that are well rooted in the 80s, but have been developed successively in the 80s and in the 90s, that allow you to compute these functions at very high order for comparable masses. Actually, in the situation where, in the extreme situation when, where let's say, one body is much smaller, the mass of one body is much smaller than the other one, this post-Newtonian calculation, thanks to Mathematica, can be pushed to very high order. So, for example, we have 20 PN accuracy for, in a sort of sense, the dynamics and the flux for a test particle orbiting around a Schwarzschild black hole. The usefulness of this is still to be really investigated. Okay, so PN theory that is actually based on two separate expansions. On the one end, you expand in V square over C square in the vicinity of the source, so you have really post-Newtonian theory there. You match this to an expansion in powers of G, which is called the post-Newtonian expansion. And then the two asymptotes are matched in an intermediate zone. Allows you, as I said, to have a good. Is actually the only analytical tool that you have to solve Einstein equation analytically, up to high order. But there is a problem here. The problem is that we solve Einstein equation as a perturbation series, which means this should be small. So we are for the post-Newtonian method to work, you have, I mean, you are expanding around with some parameters, so this parameter has to be small. You can go to very high order, but still, when these two objects are coalescing, they are coalescing at what v is half of the speed of light, which means that this parameter is not small anymore, and post-Newtonian theory just breaks down. So you need to do something else. And this something else is, okay, let me cancel this. Oop. And this something else, so let's say if this is post-Newtonian theory, so perturbation theory, that holds is this is much smaller than one. Now, what do I do? The standard old way of thinking approach was, okay, I have a perturbation series. This will work only when the velocity is small, which means when the two black holes or the two neutron stars are very far apart. Very far apart means that they are basically on a circular orbit. What I forgot to say is the following, is that in general systems, when they are binary system, when they are formed, they have some eccentricity. But gravitational waves, and they move and they emit gravitational waves. What happens is that the emission of gravitational waves is such that the orbit is circularized very fast. This is a classical calculation of the 60s of Matthews and Peters. And so that for this kind of system, we start with two black holes on circular orbits. So V over C much smaller than one means two objects very far apart, small velocities. What is the point? First point is, okay, I have post-Newtonian theory, I'm able to solve Einstein equation in some way, I know what is the dynamics, I know what is the radiation that I can emit from here, and I cannot do anything else at the moment. I need to resort to numerical computation because my analytical methods break down. Very good. So this technique, this approach was followed for years in the sense that this is what is behind what is called numerical relativity. Numerical relativity means taking Einstein equation and solving them without any approximation modulo the discretization of the grid. But in fact, numerical relativity was able to do something meaningful and was finally able to solve the binary black hole problem in 2005. Nowadays it is almost almost obvious in quotes to compute a numerical simulation of coalescing black holes, but has not always been like that, and still there are numerical relativity is not accurate enough when you have system with large mass ratios or when you want to investigate the fine detail of the emission of radiation, which means the higher multiples. Okay, so the fact that for example you don't have something like this that emits, but you want to see all the details of the source here. But what happens is that already in 2000 it was proposed something that is a resummation of post-Newtonian theory, which is called approach to the two-body dynamics. And this is one of the more 2000. Okay? So the idea was simple. The concept was very logical. I have an asymptotic series. This asymptotic series does not converge well. I do something on this. So I resum it in some form. That is, resumming means what? means taking this Taylor expansion and replacing them with non-Taylor representation, non-Taylor expansion, non-polynomial expansions that hopefully will behave well when the velocities are high and the gravitational field are strong. Which means, and was proposed, what I forgot to mention in doing this, that there is the post-Newtonian theory, but post-Newtonian theory means dynamics and actual for the waves, it use, one has to go back to the paper of Damour and Ayer of 1991, where basically there is what is called the gravitational wave generation formalism that has been then developed in high detail by the French school, which means Damour, Ayer, Blanchet, and all the legacy. And for the dynamics, in fact, dynamics means an Hamiltonian, and the Hamiltonian starts, the first person that introduced meaningfully the idea was Gerhard Hiess, Schaeffer, and then there are all the papers and the work of Damour and Schaeffer, that the last one is Damour, Jaranowski, and Schaeffer on the 4PN Hamiltonian. So, okay, just to tell you what are the pieces, I will during the lectures to show at least something meaningful for each one of these things. So, what I was saying, yes, what I was saying, that, yes, okay. So the idea was, I was talking about the resummation of post-Newtonian theory, and this effective approach means, in a single word, doing in general relativity what you do in Newtonian theory to study the two-body problem. So you map the two-body problem into a problem made by an effective particle, an effective object, which means its mass is the reduced mass of the system, moving into an effective potential. This is what you do in Newtonian theory. The idea of the effective one-body approach is to do this in full GR, which means that you will have this potential, this effective potential will be Newton plus pieces that come from GR. And the nice thing is that in doing so, the dynamics of the two-body problem that is typically very complicated in if you use a standard post-Newtonian expansion, on the one end is very much simplified, a lot of pieces go away. Because, the Hamiltonians have hundreds of terms when they are written in post-Newtonian expanded form and in a certain particular system of coordinates. So a lot of these terms disappear. But then there's more, some polynomial expansion are replaced by certain square roots. In particular, the Hamiltonian that here is given by a post-Newtonian expansion becomes as a particular structure with two nested square roots. Square roots means that you have something compact that is resummed. And the main point of this approach was to be rooted to what you know in the case of a point particle moving on a Schwarzschild black hole, plunging on a Schwarzschild black hole. So all the non-perturbative structures that exist for a point particle plunging on a black hole, for example, the fact that you have circular orbit, circular stable orbit, circular unstable orbit, and you have a last stable orbit after which you plunge, were transposed in the dynamics of the two-body problem. And in fact, the beauty of this thing is that the dynamic of the two-body problem in GR is a deformation of the dynamics of a particle on Schwarzschild black hole, and the deformation parameter is what is called the symmetric mass ratio M1, M2, divided by M1 plus M2 square. That is 0, where you have a test particle on Schwarzschild, and is 1/4 when you have a system of two objects with equal mass. Okay, yes, maybe I should have, sorry, yes, let's rewrite this. 1 plus m2 squared. This is just an introduction, but just to tell you of which kind of death you will die in a few days. Okay, very good. With this formalism in 2000, it was possible to, let's say, putting together a certain representation of the Hamiltonian and compactifying in a, also in that case in a certain suitable resummed form all the post-Newtonian information related to the gravitational wave generation, flux, and whatever, in order to include the damping terms. I mean, the fact that you have not a conservative dynamic but something that has to plunge. In 2000, they were able to say, okay, the relative dynamics of two objects of equal mass is something like this. So you start from a circular situation, and then at the moment you plunge. And moreover, this is the most important thing, to predict that a two-body system of nearly equal mass will emit a gravitational waveform of this kind. And this gravitational waveform at the time, I mean, you had this kind of dynamics that resemble very much the dynamics of a test particle on plunging on a Schwarzschild black hole. And then there is the waveform that at the time was computed using, let's say, a certain, up to this point, let's say, to the merger, using a quadruple formula, standard Einstein quadruple formula, the simple lowest order thing that you can compute in general relativity. What was not at the lowest order, evidently, was the dynamics that was done at 2pn at the time. And then, after merger, the idea was to say, okay, at this stage, I don't have any more two black holes. There is a very fast transition. I have a single black hole. But the single black hole won't be neither a Schwarzschild black hole nor a Kerr black hole. It will be a Kerr black hole, a perturbed Kerr black hole. And we know from the beginning of the 70s, I think so, yes. Oh, sorry, half of the 70s. No, but in fact, it's beginning with the 70s, that a black hole that is perturbed emits gravitational waves, and emits gravitational waves with according to certain frequencies that are called quasi-normal mode frequencies that depend, quasi-normal because they are not oscillations like this, but in fact they are damped because the gravitational wave go away. And these modes depend on the angular momentum and the mass of the black hole. So at the time they said, okay, we have up to here, we know what we have. Then there is a very fast transition, and we have this ring down tail. This was 2000, at the time where numerical relativity codes were crashing. This was a prediction that was done completely analytically, and that produced also a certain amount of other quantitative prediction. For example, the angular momentum of the final black hole, the energy radiated, and so on and so forth. Nobody was believing to this at the time. I can swear. I mean, I was not there, but I was told that this was the case. When numerical relativity came into play in 2005, they confirmed that the qualitative picture was correct. And now, and in fact, this was the first prediction of the signal, of the gravitational wave signal emitted by two coalescing black holes, and was done purely analytically. And now that we have the experiments, qualitatively correct and semi-quantitatively correct. But this was 2000. Then numerical relativity came into play, and the game now that is occupying the brain of tenth of researchers is to move some non-perturbative information from numerical relativity simulation into the analytical description in order to get very accurate waveforms. And these very accurate waveforms that are now called EOB and R, although I would prefer to call them EOB functions of NR, are those that were used in the LIGO data analysis for this event to conclude that here you had two masses, so and so, the mass ratio, the spins, and all that. For the other event, the event of December, were actually used really to extract this event from the noise. So really to do a detection. In this case, one talk about doing a parameter estimation, in the other case was doing a detection. And this is what is used and will be used. And the reason is, what I think I forgot to mention is that doing numerical relativity simulation is very expensive because you need to put the full set of Einstein equation on a supercomputer, and you need to run for months to have a very short waveform. While in this case, you can compute this waveform from the very beginning, which means thousands of cycles in some situation, purely analytically. I mean, analytically means solving ODEs, which means a couple of seconds on a laptop, or even less if your code is sufficiently accurate. And you have to compare this towards the several months of run. And the reason why you need something very efficient and accurate is that a priori you don't know what are the parameters of the source that you are going to detect or to measure. No, because there are the masses and there are the spins that can orient it in any way. So the technique is a very brute force technique. You just try, you cover the parameter space of all possible configuration in the best possible way, and then you run this bank on templates on your data until you find a good one. So this is the reason why you need analytical methods. And in fact, when you go back to the talks of 2000, 2001, or 2005, there is written, and maybe the UB might be useful to do data analysis or for detection in order to have a very efficient method. And in fact, this is exactly what was used, even if this was a bit hidden in the press conference, because evidently numerical relativity was important, but what was more important was to have an analytical method that is reliable and predictive all over. And because what I want to say is that if you used post-Newtonian results as they are, there is no way of extracting the signal from the noise. There is no, you don't have the merger because the post-Newtonian expansion just blow up. Okay, this is the picture. The global thing. Now, what I will try to do is to guide you from the beginning to the end. And I'm not sure I will be able to do this efficiently, but we will try. So all this disappears. And we start from the very beginning. This is very nice. Which means, what is a gravitational wave? I mean, because here I said a lot of words, and maybe some of them are completely, let's say, orthogonal to your knowledge. And we'll see to go, we'll try to go there step by step. By the way, I have no idea of the time. If you want to, what was this? Ah, yes, it is 1 hour. Was it 1 hour? No, it's half an hour. Yes, it's half an hour. No, I've been talking for half an hour. It's fine. Okay, so okay. Now I'll be more serious and I will take my notes. And we start from the very beginning. So the very beginning is Einstein equations. Hg divided c to the 4 t mu nu. Okay? And the idea to restart is, since I don't know what in general people here in this room have learned about gravitational wave at the university, at school, or when you were a kid, or something like that, because that it happens. I mean, there are people that study gravitational wave where they are at secondary school. I will, or other things, I mean, this I discovered recently. I will start to, from really the beginning, doing the derivation of everything. So Okay, these are Einstein equations. This is something that one should have tattooed on your arm. Or maybe the back is better. And then we do linearized approximation on the Minkowski background, assuming that this h mu nu is much smaller than 1. And evidently, I will use the convention that eta mu nu is diagonal of minus 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. Now, to do everything, let's say. First of all, let us recall that with this convention, Riemann tensor is this. I mean, you can complain if I am too pedagogical. You are allowed to do that. If it is boring, please raise your hand. It's boring. It is boring. You know, the rho h mu sigma plus the mu the sigma h nu rho minus the mu the rho h nu sigma minus the nu the sigma h mu rho. That's fine. Then, as usual, one remembers we define the trace of the metric tensor like h mu nu, sorry, this h mu nu. And then we define this quantity h bar mu nu. Really standard textbook derivation. And now what you want to do is, since this is general relativity and coordinates does not for nothing, we can do a infinitesimal coordinate transformation, which are, I'll say, so x mu is this equal x mu plus psi mu, which means that metric tensor will transform in the following form. So h mu nu, maybe here I can take the index low, equal h mu nu minus the mu psi nu plus the nu psi mu. Okay, this you know because of the diffeomorphism invariance of general relativity. When you do it at a linearized level, you have this. And then you impose a gauge. And the gauge is what is called the Lorentz, the Donder, anyway, the universality gauge, which means the new h bar mu nu, where h bar is this thing, equals 0. If you do that, you realize that, I think, if I wrote it correctly, yes, I should have plugged this, yes, before defining the gauge, it would have been good to write the full piece. I mean, once that you take Einstein equation or you linearize them with the Einstein tensor in this form, you will have that Einstein equation show their beautiful hyperbolic character, plus in the sense that the D'Alembertian comes here, eta mu nu, and then you have this piece, the sigma h bar rho sigma minus the rho the nu h bar mu rho minus the rho the nu h bar mu rho minus the rho the mu h bar nu rho equal minus 16 pi g c square t mu nu. Okay? Then what happens is that all this piece goes away because of this gauge condition, in the sense that if you take this, you put it here, you will find that everything disappears. So finally, in the Lorentz gauge, you have this. Very good. So far, so good. Now, one thing that is important to mention is that this is the harmonic gauge. But this is the linearized version. I mean, there is general representation, the general definition of the harmonic gauge, that is this, the mu g mu nu square root of minus g equals 0. And this, in fact, has to be taken into account. I mean, one has to remember that this is the general expression of the harmonic gauge, because all the post-Newtonian calculations, which means, as I said, expansion in GR, but taking into account all the non-linearities of general relativity, because here we are expanding around the flat background. Okay. In general, what you want to do, you want to solve Einstein equation on a background that is curved. Let's say first order is this, then you iterate, and things come there. Well, in all these calculations, one uses the harmonic gauge, that is this. And in fact, for example, what is nice to find is that at 1 pm level, the Einstein equation has essentially this form. And when you go to higher post-Newtonian orders, they keep maintaining this form with the subtlety that, in a sense, this T mu nu is not just the T mu nu of matter, but it also has a piece that comes from the second order or higher order terms in the metric tensor. Okay? So just to say that the harmonic gauge that here looks like something plays a very special important role in the post-Newtonian calculation. And actually also it played a special role in the first numerical relativity computation of the coalescence of black hole binaries that was done by Pretorius in 2005, because he was using also their harmonic coordinates. Okay, so so far so good. This is sufficiently basic, I think. Now we go back. What we want to do now is, so we have this Lambertian H mu nu equal minus 6 pi g over c to the 4 t mu nu. Then what I wrote here, yes. What might be interesting, because I said this, and then I imposed the harmonic gauge. That is this. Okay. What I wrote here that is something relatively instructive is the following. Let's say if I remember this. So I said, maybe I can skip this. Yes. Because something, a good exercise that I wrote here that could be useful to remember is the following. That basically is that it is, okay, typically in textbook they tell you, okay, you fix the harmonic gauge, you get this, and that. Good. But what does it mean, really, fixing the harmonic gauge? Since one is used to this transformation, so x mu prime, and in fact, a priori, I like to have to determine what is this this vector. So, in fact, what one show is that we're just doing a very simple derivation. That, in fact, I took it from the from the book of Maggiore. You can find that if let's say if you apply a general gauge transformation and you want to impose the harmonic gauge, you find that eventually you have this equation that I think is this. So the new h bar mu nu minus box say mu equals zero. And one can solve this equation. So basically, determining the harmonic gauge means determining a vector that is a gauge vector that is this, that has to satisfy this equation. And this is always a solution, because you can, this is the Lambert equation, so you can always solve this equation, and this is just the green function x minus y, the new h bar, which is indicating that you can always go in the harmonic gauge if you fix the vector in this form. Okay, so this is just a side remark. Now the next point is the next point is the following. You have these equations, you have fixed four conditions, but you still have the possibility of doing gauge transformations. You can still do gauge transformation remaining, I think, in the Lorentz gauge modulo that this is zero. Now, and this residual gauge transformation that you have finally to fix the gauge in order to single out what are the real physical components of a gravitational wave. And this is what is called the transverseless gauge, okay? Traceless gauge. And to do this, let's do first the following thing. We go in vacuum. Ah, yes, indeed. So we forget for the moment of this piece, because this piece will enter in a second moment. And we focus the wave equation in vacuum. And we look, we search for plane waves. So he said a tensor, and then, okay, Ka, Xa. Well, we take a wave, for example, that is propagating along the z-axis, the wave vector just omega 0, 0, omega. When you plug this here, you find that you have the following. And this is a transversality condition, which means that this tensor is orthogonal to the wave vector. So whatever it happens, it will happen when you go to three dimensions in this plane. And then you have this. Now, what is now you have this thing, and you realize that you have six independent components of these polarization tensors. As I said, if you go in the along the z-axis, you can write a piece in this plane that can be, for example, you have one vector that is this, 0, 1, 0, 0, and then you have another vector, 0, 0, 1, 0. And these are six components. You can imagine to build up all the possible tensors possible epsilon mu nu tensors that satisfy this condition, so all the possible tensors that are transverse to the direction of propagation. And you can do this using this basis vector and k. The game that I'm playing here is the following. So this is a general solution. I can build the most general tensor. And then I want to see which components of these tensors are actually invariant for gauge transformations. And it's a different way of seeing the TT gauge, but I think it is instructive, because in this way you will realize that when you write things in this form and you are not finally fixing the TT gauge, you can have modes that are physical, in fact, that are independent of the gauge transformation, and other modes that are just gauge. By the way, these modes are the longitudinal modes and the non-transverse and the non-transverse mode. So, for example, you have these tensors, and you can write a basis that is like this: epsilon nu 1 minus epsilon mu 2 epsilon 2 nu, and this I call it for the moment H plus mu nu. So you realize that this will be one of the good ones because it has a name. And then plus epsilon nu 1 epsilon mu 2. Okay, I define, maybe the definition was not perfect. So it's 1 and 2. So these are the two vectors. And this is, I will call, a cross mu nu. Then I can build other tensors. So this 1 k mu epsilon mu 2 k nu plus epsilon nu 2 k mu, then k mu k nu, and then finally epsilon mu 1 epsilon nu 1 plus epsilon mu 2 epsilon nu 2. Good. Yes. Now, what happens is that if you now you have these things, you can apply, you can evidently do a gauge transformations here in the usual form that we rewrite for completeness, which means that you can take which goes in H mu nu minus yes, maybe I made a mistake before, but okay, the mu xi nu plus the nu xi mu minus the rho xi rho eta mu nu, and then you will find that if you apply a gauge transformation to this, the only pieces that are invariant are these ones, while all the others will depend on the gauge. Okay, and in fact, depend on the gauge. And in fact, you can always choose a gauge such that these pieces disappear, while you are never able to make these pieces disappear because of a gauge choice. Okay, now so this is the point. I mean, this is a simple calculation that you can do as an exercise, and this, by the way, is instructive. Here I forgot a sign, because it's a minus omega. And finally, you can choose a gauge that, as I said, is transverse and traceless, which means that the trace is zero. Well, the trace is defined, I mean, in the usual way, so is h mu nu eta mu nu, trace of the h bar vector. You put the other, the zero I components to zero, and then trace tac tac, and then evidently you still have the transversality condition. Okay. Now, once that you are here, it means that you are killing all these pieces. You have just this, and if you are in the direction of propagation of the waves, and okay, we are talking about as usual plane waves, so it's yes. Eventually, you will see that when you are in the TT gauge, your wave will be like this: AJ plus an amplitude plus AJ cross amplitude, and then kappa mu x mu, where kappa k mu is, as I was saying, min omega 0 0 omega. So if you are here now, so in you are in the plane orthogonal to the wave, and you have chosen that base, what happens is that these two tensors are, so all this is zero. What happens is this, yes. So let's say you have just the spatial components, so is 1 minus 1 0, and is 0 1 1 0. Okay, this in the particular frame where yes, you have put your axis in this way. Evidently, in general, if you have a wave that is propagating from a general direction, all these tensors will be modified by theta and phi things. Okay, so this is the transverse traceless gauge, and maybe we can stop 5 minutes now. No, maybe I can say one more thing here. Yes, because this is important, and it is another piece of jargon, and then we stop. In general, if you have actually, if you have a solution of Einstein equation, the harmonic gauge, there is a way of taking it and projecting it on the transverse stressless gauge. And in fact, this is made by means of an object that is a projector. Because, I mean, yes, these are just the only physical components of the thing. And, I mean, there is this object, EJKL, which is, okay, let me write it and then I will explain. PJL minus 1/2 PEJ PKL, where a okay, the point is the following. No? Now, I was basically, the frame that I'm using, I'm sitting with the wave, okay? So when I have minus 0, 0 this way, I am sitting with the wave, so the wave is propagating in this direction, I am here. And I see that my tensor have just those components. But in general, I can have a waveform, okay, if this is the origin of my x, y, z, I have a waveform that is propagating along the n direction from a source. And then what I want to see is to single out the physical components of the wave. Here I will depend basically on the coordinate, but I want to be here in order to extract the TT gauge. In particular, this is true if, let's say, this is the frame of the source, so here I have something that is emitting gravitational waves, this goes away. Here I have my detector, and my detector wants to see something there. So, and I will see just the physical components. So what I do is I take the, for example, the wave in the harmonic gauge, and I project it on this frame, which is orthogonal to the radial direction. And I use this using this projector operators that basically when you apply this thing to anything, it will kill all the components that are non-transverse and non-traceless. And you can easily write the explicit expression of this, so that in fact IJ TT gauge is pi EJKL HKL. I mention this explicitly because this operator will enter in will appear several times whenever we, for example, we solve the linearized equation, the quadrupole in the quadrupole approximation, and all that. You do calculations using the harmonic gauge, but eventually you want to have the TT gauge components, and these TT gauge components are, for example, those that are that enter the expression of the energy and angular momentum or linear momentum on the way. So is a technical piece that is important to have and to remember. So far, so good. Let's stop for 5 minutes so that I breathe and you too. Ora facciamo che qua c'è a più. Across minus I plus elevato a I k x meno omega t. Okay. Yes? Yeah, sure. In fact, you have to understand that all node reference frames are the same. There are some that are worse than others, and even if they don't count anything, because everything is gauge invariant, it's good to have some coordinate system. So you should have interrupted me before, saying, please, wide. Huh? Okay, I will remember. In fact, you see, here I stopped and I tried to put it larger. Okay. What I realized that I have to mention is something about the helicity of gravitational waves, so the fact that the helicity, the gravitational wave has have helicity too, which is related to the fact that you can see this as a field of spin too. So the main point is this, that you can define, say, okay, let's say this is a gravitational wave in the TT gauge. Finito. They are not missing much. Okay. So let's say in the next hour I will let's play a bit with the waves TT gauge for whatever I can do. So first of all, let us remember what helicity gravitational waves. So you can you have this wave in the TT gauge. You can define helicity amplitudes as plus or minus 2, which means a plus minus I A cross. Okay, and the point is this. So you have basically, so you are again in this, yeah, and you are living in the plane orthogonal to the direction of propagation. The point is that you can do a rotation of the coordinates here, and you can see what happens at the tensor when you rotate the coordinate system. And what happens is that if you write this combination of the two amplitudes, if you do a rotation, what happens is that plus or minus these helicity amplitudes defined in this way are, when you do a rotation, actually the tensor, the amplitude rotates by a factor 2, a plus minus 2. And this is what is, I mean, if you do the same thing for an electromagnetic field, here you find 1. If you do the same thing, I mean, in general, if you apply a rotation to a field and if you find it an S, you will have that, you will say that the field has helicity S, said in a very bad way. But anyway, this is the important thing. This is related to the fact that you see, okay, this is a tensor with two indexes, is a spin two field and these kind of things. Just as a reminder. And now, what I wanted to say is the following. So probably you have seen a lot of movies or let's talk about the interaction of gravitational wave in the TT gauge with matter. What do they do? Because probably you have seen, yes, I have this, I have a collection of particles like this, right? And then when the wave arrives, let's say a wave that impinges on the blackboard in this direction, if you have one polarization, so in particular is the plus polarization, it will do something like this. So the particles will be deformed in this direction or in the other, while if you have the cross polarization, you get the same but rotated by 45 degrees. Good. This is what, yes? Sure, of course, but yes, that's the only pieces that indeed it is that I just wrote what was important in this case, and also the fact anyway you rotate in the plane. Now, so for the plus polarization you have this kind of drawing, and for the cross polarization you have the same thing but rotated to 45 degrees. Good. Now, how can I investigate or analyze the effect of gravitational waves on matter? First of all, let us see what gravitational wave do. Let's say if I have a particle, a single particle, and I want to study the effect of a gravitational wave on a single particle, I will find that nothing will happen, because basically the space-time is moving, the particle is moving with the space-time and with the coordinates, and you won't see any effect. And you can demonstrate this easily, because if you take the, let's say, just the geodesic equation, plus dx mu over the tau, dx nu over the tau equals zero, evidently a wave in the TT gauge, and you write everything, you will find, what was it? Yes, so let's say, imagine there is a particle at rest in a certain point, and I want to see whether the gravitational waves move this part, moves these particles or not, this particle or not. I write the geodesic equation, so I say, that, okay, UE is what I'm saying. Yes, I'm at rest, so I have just one component, so let's say this is the x axis or whatever, so the one, and what I have is that the geodesic equation, once that you do all the calculation, assuming, okay, the particle is initially at rest, so that the for velocity is just uj equal zero, no, sorry, yes, and u0 is equal one, I think. And you look at the geodesic equation, that becomes something like this, u0 square. Yes. Yes, because it's u0, u0, so there are two u0 that come here, at tau equals zero. And then you write the Christoffel symbol for using the metric in the TT gauge, and you find that gamma e0, 0 is just 1/2 to t0 h0e. Minus the H0, A, sorry, is again too small. I apologize. Let me rewrite. Gamma E 0, 0 is equal 1/2 to the 0 H0 E minus the I H0, 0. Okay? But you are in the TT gauge, so H0 E equals 0 and H0, 0 equals 0. Conclusion, there is no effect, okay? But the fact that you don't see something locally does not mean that there is no physical effect. Because in fact, what, there is this thing, what one has to look at is first to look at proper distances, in fact. So, because similarly, using, I mean, actually, the tool that one has to use to study the effect of gravitational waves on matter, and in particular, what is then used, for example, to compute the response of the detector, at least at the geometric level, is what is called the equation of geodesic deviation. And in fact, what you have to do is not to be, you have to compare different points in the space-time. In other words, what you see here is just the manifestation of the equivalence principle. So if I am if I am in one point, I can remove the gravitational field by a suitable coordinate transformation. In fact, what happened here? In general, I could have an effect, but I went to the TT gauge and this is removed, and this is zero. This is actually true at linear order. You could have second order effects, but let's say if this is what you see on a detector on Earth, the second order effects are completely canceled. Actually, more generally speaking, it is true that locally you can remove the gravitational field, in the sense you can remove the Christoffel symbols, but if there is a gravitational field, which means you have curvature there, you can still feel something because there is tidal interaction. so that you have a tidal field that is there even if you are in a freely falling elevator, as the usual thing. So with the local experiments comparing two different points of space-time, because this is what happens, because if you have, I mean, if you're in a point, you don't see anything, but if you have something that is extended, no, for example, that is like this in absence of a gravitational field, but you have a gravitational field here, and this is deformed because of tidal interaction, you could see something and sense that the gravitational field exists. But this is not one point, it's an extended thing. And this is related to the fact that you have some curvature. So, to analyze the effect of the gravitational wave, what you need is the equation of geodesic deviation. Equation of geodesic deviation means what? That you have two geodesics. One is here, x in with coordinate. Then this is a vector that connects the two, and this is x mu plus sine mu. You write the geodesic equations for one case, sorry. So the geodesic equation for this case, for these geodesics, the tau square plus gamma mu nu rho dx And then for the nearby geodesics, which means the same, where you take x mu plus same mu plus ta 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 ta, okay, the same. Then you compute the difference and you work at a linear order in psi. What you get? You get an equation for the acceleration, for the relative acceleration between the two geodesics, so in fact, force between the two objects, plus 2 gamma mu nu rho x dot nu. Ah, yes, the dot, evidently, this means the x mu over the tau. Okay. Plus sigma the sigma gamma mu nu rho x dot rho equals 0. Okay, so this is the equation of geodesic deviation that tells you what is the relative motion between the two objects, freely falling particles, and in fact, in general, this can also be written. Just for you to know that there is also a notation, because this can be seen as a. Actually, you can recombine all these things with a symbol that indicates the covariant derivatives along curves. If I well remember, yes. And so that you can write, you can find the geodesic equation, the equation of geodesic deviation written in this form. Yes, the psi mu over the tau plus gamma mu nu rho v nu the psi rho over the tau. And okay. What is missing is the definition of this geodesic deviation equation. Okay, so in fact, in order to monitor the effect of gravitational waves, is better to use this thing. So, okay, we say if I am sitting in a point that is initially at rest, it will remain at rest. Why? Because the space-time is moving, but the particle is moving with it, so you don't see any effect. All said, yeah. Then, what you can do, the other thing that you can also do, is to apply this geodesic deviation equation to two particles that have a certain separation, x mu, but this is just the normal distance, not the coordinate distance. So, and you realize again that there is no physical effect. To see a physical effect, as I said, you have to compute the proper distances between the two objects, which means really looking at the metric, which is this, g mu nu dx mu dx nu, and put here the gravitational wave, and then integrate this between one point and the other. Okay, so coordinate distance, there is no effect. In a point, there is no effect. If you look at proper distances where you use correctly the metric to do the computation, I mean, you are on a spacetime, you are in a geometry, you will see an effect due to gravitational wave. And in fact, if you do this, you will see that you have minus square plus, this is delta Ej, plus H Ej TT, dxc dxj. Okay, so let's suppose, let's imagine that we have two points, x1, x2, separated by a distance L. And if you, with the usual, let's say, plane wave that is impinging on the blackboard, and you said that, okay, you computed the S, which means the square root of this thing, and then you do the integration, and what happens, what you find eventually, is that the distance, which means the integral of the S between x1 and x2, is equal to x2 minus x1 times 1 plus 1 half H plus, for example, cos omega t. I mean, imagine, okay, here I was assuming that I have a wave, let's say that H ij tt is a pure linear polarized wave H plus cos omega t a ij plus, okay? Is it large enough what I wrote? And what you see is the following, that the coordinated separation now is oscillating because of the presence of this term. In practical terms, what it means is that each particle is like if it sensed a force that is locally moving it. And this is, by the way, the way you detect the gravitational wave in first approximation, because what happens, okay, imagining that the case of a bar detector, but this is also what happens for the interferometer, that you have the two arms, the waves arrives here, one arm is stretched in one direction, I mean, is squeezed, the other one is stretched, and this changes the optical length of the arms, and you see light at the photodiode instead of seeing absence of signal. So this is basically what is there, and allows you to understand what is the effect of gravitational waves on matter. I mean, if you look at textbooks, the book of Maggiore, Ruffini, or whoever, you can apply this thing to the ring of particle and understand why this thing is moving one direction or in the other direction. And similarly, actually, you can also see things in a probably in a slightly different way. I mean, you can apply again the geodesic deviation equation, but now not on coordinate distances, but on proper distances. And when you work, I think, at linearized level, let's write it here. What you will have is that the acceleration, proper acceleration is this thing, hij between sj, okay? That is, once that you apply the geodesic deviation equation to the proper distances, you can get this thing. And this very briefly summarizes how you can the wave interact with the matter, maybe even too briefly. But the next point is that, okay, if maybe I can do this calculation in detail. Yes, I can do that. Because here this is applied just to one, let's say, one arm of the interferometers. Of the interferometer, we can clean. Yeah, sorry, can I erase? Yes, nobody's taking notes. That's good, because you know that this is registered, so you don't need notes. So we said this was the geodesic deviation equation, and then okay, let's go. We are in the detector. That the idea is x and y, and there is a wave that is moving along the z-axis, and let us suppose that these are the arms of the interferometer, and we have our equation that is, now I don't remember the sign, but this was written like this, tt xj. Now, what is this? Yes, anyway, you can apply the following, is that each, yes, what will do the arms have, let's say, you have an L shape, and this L shape without any gravitational wave has just length L. So what the gravitational wave will do, will take L plus, sorry, a certain deformation. You take this, you apply the geodesic deviation equation, and then you compute the difference between the two things. And eventually what happens is that you find that the difference between the because what happens is that you will have x1, so the wave will stretch one arm, which means that this might be called z1. Yes, sorry, x is y. So let's say this is, maybe a color is better. Okay. So you have the wave that is arriving. The arm by itself is fixed this, and is this. And this is L and L. Now, there is the wave. What the wave does is adding something here, and we call it Z1, and probably reducing something there, and we call this Z2. So you will apply the geodesic deviation equation on both sides, and then eventually what you compute is the difference between Z1 and Z2. This is what is important, because this is what allows you eventually to see whether there is a gravitational wave or not, in the sense that the interferometer are built in a way that when there is no gravitational wave, you have some, let's do a brief scheme, okay? You have some light that is moving, then there is the beam splitter, so that the single light is split in two. Then there are mirrors that go back, and then things are recombined, and here you have a photodiode that sees something. So when there is no gravitational wave, the idea is that the light is in phase opposition, so that you see dark. Dark means noise, evidently, but let's say that the idea is to keep this noise the smallest possible. If you have a gravitational wave, one arm is stretched, let's say going in this direction. The other one is squeezed, because it's what we were saying before, no? If we have a ring of particle, one is is moving like this, and then the other way. And this squeeze and stretch means Z1, Z2. So what is important is this difference, Z1 and Z2, because this difference will mean that this wave train will be shifted, and instead of seeing dark, you will see some light and finally measure something. I mean, this is what happened. So you compute this difference, and eventually you find that you have, this is L, so the original length, times Hij, times a tensor, the Ej, that is what is called the detector tensor. Let's say a tensor that characterizes the geometry of the detector. For interferometer, this detector is just 1/(1,0,0-1,0,0,0,0). Okay, but this is, let's say, a useful concept to retain, that the geometry of the detector is related to a tensor when you look at this thing, because eventually what you measure is actually this. This is delta L, and what is important is this delta L over L, which is this Hij dEj, that is what is H, which is what is called the strain. So it's really the modification in the arms of the detector. Now, this looks simple, that's true. But one has to remember that in practice, this is like this, just if you are in the detector frame. If you then want to do the real thing, which means that you are on the surface of Earth, so you have, for example, for the two LIGOs, you have one LIGO in Louisiana, another LIGO here in Washington, so you have probably to be in the center of frame of the, sorry, in the frame of the Earth. So all these tensors have some dependence on the position they have on the Earth, and when you compare things, you have to take into account all the angles and all that, and moreover the fact that, you know, you have a wave that is arriving from wherever, you don't know. So just to say that when you go in the actual implementation, you will have angles that are appearing everywhere. Yes, so I think this is good enough to give you a flavor of what happens. I mean, this is really the basis of the thing. Enough to, I think, to understand what is going on. Questions here? Yes. No, sorry, say it again.
Okay, so you're shooting these laser beams back and forth, and then you see the point of the detector being shortened and lengthened. Won't it be the case that the detector won't be able to pick up what happens, or it will only be able to pick it up modulo an integer number of the wavelength of the light that you're using in your laser? Because all that matters is the phase difference between the two waves, right?
Yes. Ah, I don't know. will it happen? I don't know. I mean, what you mean is that if the detector becomes, yes, it's exactly moving so that I don't see anything. Maybe the probability that this happens is much smaller than all the rest, no? Because it's just one particular case among all the other possibility. Yes, certainly, of course, there could be, what you are saying is that I could be blind to some signal, but anyway, the signal will change in time. So it's okay, let's put it in this way. Yes, if we had a continuous, yes, okay, maybe the answer is the following. What you want to see is a signal that does like this. So maybe you're right, it could be a moment where you don't see anything, but then things will change immediately. Certainly, if you had a continuous, imagine that you have a continuous gravitational wave signal that is just moving this and remains in phase. Okay, but this might be a situation, but it's not what is actually happening. And in general, I think there are let's say all these things are stochastic fluctuation. It's not that you are exactly like this. So this was just an example to give you an idea. Actually, everything is fluctuating. So when you look at the noise of the detector, it's not just the theoretical things like this. It's something that is all like this. And okay. Now, okay, these are the big things. Now, so let us summarize a bit, because this is just to give you sort of dictionary at this level of the basics of what is. So let's say we said HJJTT, then the, okay. So H00 equals 0, H0E equals 0, and then the EHIJ equals 0. And this is the TT gauge. Okay, so transverse versus traceless. Then matter interaction . So we said proper distances, effect, and then interaction. Detector. This, in a sense, just to give you some takeaway words and name so that you can check. Yes, and geodesic deviation, the equation of geodesic deviation. Yes, it's far from being well written, sorry. Rewrite again. No, I was just trying to summarize what are the takeaway message. Yes. No. Sorry. Here, what I'm discussing here is the case where we have a wave that is propagating in vacuum, that is arriving on Earth. Here, we are not calculating anything at the moment. So we are assuming that this wave exists. And then we are just saying, okay, if this wave exists, let us figure out what are the physical components of this wave, because there is still some gauge there that you have to eliminate in order to see what is the physical effect. And then what you want to see is physically how this wave interacts with matter. These waves that arrives from somewhere else. So this wave can be anything. So in the sense that it can be a wave emitted by a core collapse supernova, it can be a wave emitted by two black holes coalescing, it can be the wave emitted by myself moving my hands. Okay? So this is very weak. Let's say, if you wish, this is just the end product, but this is typically what is taught in courses, on average, at least to my knowledge, this is what is said in Italy, in the sense that, for example, the problem of generation of gravitational wave, this is another problem. So, which means that for the moment, what we are working is on this equation. Okay? But maybe there is a minus, I don't remember. And then there is the problem of what happens if you have a source. And this is the gravitational wave generation problem that I don't want to start discussing today. Because in fact, in the last 10 minutes, what I want is to summarize something else that will be useful. So let's rewrite this. So interaction with matter. So I've said this because typically, I mean, it was very, you could see everywhere this ring of particles moving, stretching and squeezing. And okay, what is going on? What is that? This is what is there. So at least in a very simple and simple-minded way. Now, what else? What else? So let's put, let's summarize. I won't give too many technical details, but let's summarize something that is useful and will be used anywhere, everywhere later. So what I said, okay, I have two particles. If the waves arrives here, I compute the proper distance and I see that the proper distance varies, which means that the gravitational wave can make some sort of work in the usual sense. This also means that the gravitational wave can, so this means that gravitational wave can carry energy. They carry also linear momentum and they also carry angular momentum like electromagnetic waves. Yes, what I did not discuss in detail was the analogy with electromagnetism, but I think this is not relevant. So what I want to summarize is are just the some the useful formula for these calculations. So in for these quantities, in particular, first the computation of the stress energy tensor of gravitational waves, because this is what is behind this. So you need you can define a stress energy tensor for gravitational waves, and from this you derive all these formulas. Well, these formulas are important. Are important in describing the dynamics of binary systems, because and whatever, because what you want is to understand how much energy is emitted, or angular momentum is emitted, and in post-Newtonian calculation, in order to compute in a self-consistent manner the dynamics, as I said, I have some conservative part that can be described by an Hamiltonian, but then I have to take into account the fact that there is emission of gravitational waves. The emission of gravitational waves carries away angular momentum, energy, and linear momentum, and this is what eventually back reacts of the system and makes it plunge. Okay, because it's like having two objects that are moving in a dissipative medium. I mean, in fact, this is what we are talking about. So you start with a circular orbit, and progressively the orbit becomes smaller and smaller because you radiate something. So the I'm not sure that I'm able to give all. No, I'm not able at all to give all the details. But let's write things in a very simple way, because the stress energy tensor of gravitational waves, I think there are there is the classical work of Isaacson of the 1968-69, and then there is of course the Landau-Lifshitz, which is the Bible. And what is important is the following. So let's say that you take just the vacuum equation, so R mu nu equals zero. The point is this: R mu nu bar mu nu. If you stop at linear order, but you can also have, let's say, okay, if you, you have this, you have also the second, the quadratic, then R mu nu, and so on and so forth. And the idea is what? You take this, you put it on the right. And the first order, this is what gives you, first approximation, the stress energy tensor of gravitational waves. But there is a subtlety. And the subtlety is the following. So let's say I can write this approximately like this, and then here I is the following, is that I cannot define locally energy of gravitational waves, because locally I can change coordinates and everything disappears. So the way of defining this thing is always taking averages over several wavelengths of the or let's say over an extended region of space. So you cannot localize energy in one point, energy is localized in a region. And whenever you define these objects, it is implicit that what you are doing is an average over a certain region of space-time. What happens is, for example, if you say the stress energy tensor, which means, let's say we call it T mu nu, which is just, I think that the correct definition is just 32 over G, and then you have the mu H alpha beta, the nu H alpha beta, okay, with this average thing there. And when you go in the transverse traceless gauge, evidently, okay, what I forgot to say, I mean, what I want to say is the following. If you take the gauge modes and you compute this thing, this will be just zero, will disappear. So only the gauge invariant pieces contribute to this thing. And when you go, indeed, in this transverse traceless gauge, what happens is that this will just read HAJ TT, the new HIJ TT. Okay? In fact, here I think I did something. I saw, yes, an instructive thing. And, okay. Okay, and for example, you will see, evidently, you have the important thing is that the energy density is just the 0,0 component to pi g h dot ej tt h dot ij tt. Okay? Now, yes, then you have the conservation. Evidently, if you are on a linearized theory, this object is conserved with the flat space-time metric. So we are always thinking that I have eta mu nu plus h mu nu plus the second thing, but the second thing is on the right, and when you compute the conservation of the Bianchi denting conservation of energy in angular momentum, the conservation of the stress energy tensor, this is just a normal flat space-time derivative. Now, what is in fact then useful and will be used are the fluxes, which means, okay, if this gives you the energy density or the angular momentum density or the, yes, what you want to compute is the flux or of energy, which means the, for example, the time derivative of energy, which is this. Of h dot e j t t h dot e j t t. So for myself, I did all the detailed calculations of this in order to go to the final formulas, because you have some integral over the sphere, and then I think you use the Gauss theorem to remove the disintegration, or to do these integrations, or maybe not, but okay. No, indeed not, yes. So this is one piece that will be useful later, because the computation of the energy flux is one of the things that is needed, as I said, in the theory of the two-body problem, and also what is important this is important. Why this is important? Because the way post-Newtonian calculations, especially for the waves, is to say, okay, I have a system. This system has a certain energy, a certain mechanical energy, and the variation of this mechanical energy, let's say, which means is equal, let's say, mechanical, is equal to minus the E over dt gravitational wave. That is the a balance equation. So what I miss, what I lose in mechanical energy, just goes away in gravitational waves. So I need to, I mean, this is a formula that will be used and that can be computed at high order in post-Newtonian theory. And similarly, you have analogous formulas for the linear momentum, for the flux of linear momentum, which is minus c cube r square 32 pi g divided by the omega h dot ej tt the k h ij tt, and for the angular momentum, epsilon I B X K the L H A B T T plus 2 H dot A L H A K T T. Now, what does it mean? Okay, energy we understand, angular momentum we understand, more or less. So this is the dominating contribution when you have a system in circular orbit. Then there is also the linear momentum that is carried away from gravitational wave. And in fact, this is another relevant effect in binary black hole coalescence, because carrying away linear momentum, I mean, there is an effect, there is linear momentum that is carried away from gravitational wave, and the result is that the center of mass of the system will recoil. So, and this can be a huge effect, at least this has been studied in detail in numerical relativity and also in analytical calculation. But just to say that each of these things, I mean, now you see these are basic formulas that then we will use later, and we will do the explicit computation starting from this for the simplest case of a binary system in Newtonian theory using the quadrupole formula. So going really from the beginning to the end, so that you will see what is the energy flux in that case, what is the angular momentum flux, that actually for circular orbits they are proportional, and then you will discover that for just Newtonian system on circular orbits the linear momentum emission is just zero. So I think that all the derivations and all the discussion to get these expressions, I think I got them either from the book of Straumann, or yeah, probably from the book of Straumann, not from the book of Maggiore. But then, okay, this is just for you to remind. It's not. I did some of the derivation, and I had some notes for that to get it explicitly. Okay, it's just important to keep this in mind, because there will be tools that will reappear later. And I think we can stop at this stage. Questions? I didn't ask. No. Okay, go home, please. It's fine. You are maybe a bit worn out at this stage.